Order, the final stage of the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Criminal Justice and Support for Victims Bill. Before I call Lord Morrow to move the final stage and open the debate on the bill, I would like to inform the House that consent for the bill, as amended, has been received from the Secretary of State. Lord Morrow.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I beg to move that the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Criminal Justice and Support for Victims Bill do now pass. Mr Deputy Speaker, I'm very glad to rise today, although much earlier than I anticipated, and I suspect the rest of the House did, but anyway, that's the way things go sometimes. To open the final stage debate on my Human Trafficking and Exploitation Bill. As members will appreciate, the passage of this bill has been a long journey for me. It is nearly 3 years ago that I first decided that I'd like to take this bill forward. It will be no surprise to anyone here to hear me say that I'm glad that this process is reaching a successful conclusion today. In my opinion, opening remarks today, I want to explain what underpins my desire to bring this bill forward before going up to outline my heartfelt thanks to many individuals who played a very significant role in seeing this bill come this far. Members may be aware that I am a practicing Christian like many others around this House today, and as a Christian I have always strongly believed that every human person is made in the image of God and therefore has an intrinsic dignity that must be respected. Human trafficking is a horrific abuse of a person made in the image of God. The process of bringing this legislation to the Assembly has made abundantly clear to me that every member of this House, regardless of their faith or lack of it, agrees that human trafficking is a heinous crime which needs to be tackled in this province, even if there was some disagreement on how best to achieve that goal. For me, taking action in this area was very much motivated by my Christian faith and principles, and I'm not ashamed to say so. For others seeking to tackle this crime, their motivation comes from another source. When I heard that this crime was taking place in Northern Ireland, I wanted to see what I could do to bolster our response as a country. As a member of this Assembly, I know that I was in a position to make a difference in this area, so I looked into the subject and sought to see if we could improve our response. Mr Deputy Speaker, I brought this bill forward because I believed that we in Northern Ireland could have a better legislative framework to tackle human trafficking and exploitation. From the very start of this process, I had three main aims for my bill. Firstly, I wanted to improve support services for victims of trafficking and exploitation to ensure that those who have suffered from these crimes and are appropriately supported and cared for. Secondly, I wanted to reduce demand for human trafficking and exploitation in Northern Ireland through a variety of different measures. Thirdly, I wanted to ensure that perpetrators of these heinous crimes are effectively punished. The bill we will be voting on later today looks different in some respects from the bill that I first introduced to this Assembly. The positive changes that have been made throughout the legislative process in this Assembly ensures that the bill meets the aims that I set for it from the outset. I'm also very pleased that this Assembly has been able to agree on a piece of legislation that goes much further than that which has been put forward in the Modern Slavery Bill at Westminster. It is rare for us in this Assembly to lead the way in the United Kingdom in the area of policy, but we clearly are doing so through this bill, and parliamentarians at Westminster recognise it. And at this juncture, I would urge Westminster parliamentarians to consider introducing the changes we are making through this bill during the passage of the Modern Slavery Bill. This is especially the case with regard to the introduction of guardians for trafficked and separated children and the statutory guarantee of support for victims of human trafficking. Mr Deputy Speaker, it will be the case that if this Assembly passes this legislation today, as I very much hope it will, that victims of human trafficking will be better provided for in Northern Ireland than they are in other parts of the United Kingdom. The British Government would do well to reflect on that as the modern slavery bill continues its passage through Westminster. I would urge Westminster to follow us in criminalising the purchase of sexual services. We, of course, have followed others in doing so, including Sweden, Norway, Iceland and now Canada. I will not dwell on the debate on Clause 15 much today. A lot of time has been given to it throughout this process, and it clearly has been the most divisive aspect of my bill. What I will say is this: I brought forward this proposal because I believe, on the basis of the evidence that we have seen in other jurisdictions, that it is the most effective way of tackling human trafficking for the purposes of sexual exploitation and the exploitation of individuals involved in prostitution. I do not believe that this approach will solve everything, nor have I ever suggested that it would. In reality, like with many complex social issues, there is no perfect way of tackling the issues involved. But the evidence clearly suggests that the approach modelled by Sweden is the best available, and it recognises the abuses involved in the prostitution industry and seeks to reduce the core driver for prostitution, the demand for sex, for paid sex. I can understand why certain members oppose this approach. Some of the arguments made had some merit. But on balance, I and the vast majority of members of this House felt that it was the right way for Northern Ireland. And I should say that it is an irony, I think, that allegedly the most controversial part of my bill received the largest majority in voting. That was, of those voting, nearly 90% voted for it, and I think that speaks for itself. Members, I close today, Deputy Speaker, but before I do that, I want to put on record my thanks to a number of individuals for the work that they put in on the bill. Firstly, I'd like to convey again my thanks to the Minister for Justice and his civil servants for how he has worked with me throughout the passage of this bill. I think it is safe to say that the Minister and his team were sceptical when I first announced that I wanted to bring forward this legislation. I can, of course, understand why this might be the case. After all, I was a member of another political party looking to bring forward legislation which affected the Minister's department. However, I am very grateful the Minister over time came to the view that he could support many aspects of my bill, and he and the civil servants have worked constructively with me on its contents, even though he disagreed with aspects of what I was proposing. It is to his credit that he was willing to put aside party difference to work with me on something as important as this subject. I can sincerely say that the bill that is before the House today has been significantly improved as a consequence of the department positively engaging with me on its contacts. I also want to give special mention to one particular civil servant in the Department of Justice, Julie Wilson. Julie will no doubt be very pleased to see the back of me after this bill completes its passage through the Assembly. She had to deal with the complexities of working on this bill when there was no real blueprint of how to go about it. She conducted herself with constant professionalism throughout and was always helpful to me as I sought to engage with the department. It is very clear to me that she is a real credit to the Northern Ireland Civil Service. The Minister, as I am sure he will agree, is very fortunate to have her in his department. Secondly, I want to say thank you to the current Minister for Health and his predecessor for their positive engagement with me on aspects of my bill. Both Minister Poots, as he then was, and Minister Wells were fully supportive of what I was trying to achieve through this bill and did their utmost to help ensure that the best provisions could be drawn up. I am very grateful to them both for their support in this matter. I should further add that the civil servants in the Department of Health did an excellent job in seeing good provisions come before this House. Thirdly, I would like to thank all the members of the Justice Committee who scrutinised the bill while it was passing through the Assembly. I know that it was not easy for members of the committee to deal with some of what was discussed. The subjects of prostitution and human trafficking are not easy ones to handle. However, the committee did a superb job in scrutinising the legislation and suggesting improvements which could be made to it. All of the members from across the parties give this subject the attention it deserved, and I believe that it has shown itself to be one of the best committees, that is, aside from, of course, the Environment Committee, but it has proved itself on many occasions during this bill. And I do not want to forget either the work of the committee's staff with regard to my bill. Having been the chair of the Justice Committee in the past, I know how exceptional they are, and I am sure that the committee would want to pay tribute to them for their work on this bill. I also want to give a special mention to Paul Given for his work as chair of the committee. I know that he will soon be stepping down as chair, but I want to thank him for his hard work on this bill. Paul showed a sure hand in considering this legislation, and I have no doubt he is destined for greater things in the months and the years ahead, and I wish him well. And I hope he enjoys his private members' bill process as much as I have, as he brings forward his private members' bill in the coming months. And the one thing that I would say to him here today, he has plenty of work ahead of him, and I can tell him that from experience. And could I just also mention the clerk of the Justice Committee, Christine Darrow, who was totally professional in all her dealings with me during this, what seemed an eternity. It is almost, Deputy Speaker, 3 years since I started down this journey. And I suspect that many got weary of me, and at times I felt weary, but not weary of them, but weary in another way. Fourthly, I want to thank the Attorney General and his staff for their assistance in bringing this bill forward. The Attorney was consistently available to me throughout the passage of this bill and ever willing to consider the legal issues which arose with regard to it, and I hasten to add there were many. I greatly appreciated his wisdom and insight with regard to the provisions of my bill alongside those of his staff. I think we in the Assembly are fortunate to have someone as bright and intelligent and gifted as the current Attorney General. Fifthly, I want to pay tribute to the Bill Office here at the Assembly, particularly Eilish Haughey and Damien Martin. The process of bringing a bill before the Northern Ireland Assembly is a complicated one, and both Eilish and Damien did a fantastic job in guiding me and my team through the process here at the Assembly. They both were constantly helped from start to finish and were always willing to help out in any way they could. I am grateful, very grateful to them, both for their work on this matter. Having such high-quality staff in the Bill Office at the Assembly really does make a real difference in terms of guiding legislation through this place. And I must also name another sitting to your left hand, Deputy Speaker, Patricia Casey, who at the very early stages, her guidance, advice and support was invaluable as she sought to steer me and at times maybe settle me down when things were, I thought, maybe not just going. But I want to put on record my appreciation to Patricia also. Sixthly and finally, I want to say thank you to the many NGOs who helped to support me throughout the passage of this bill. A considerable number of NGOs contributed to the consultation on my bill and gave evidence to the Justice Committee on its contents. I am thankful to every NGO who has contributed to this process. Without a doubt, this bill has improved by their input. I want to single out a couple in particular. Firstly, CARE. I am extremely grateful to CARE for their excellent briefings and advice throughout the many years of this bill's development. Their expertise has assisted me greatly as I have sought to understand the issue of human trafficking here in Northern Ireland. I would particularly name a few. Dr. Don Boucher, Mark Bailey, Louise Gleachin and Claire Wilson-Thomas were absolutely superb. They were very professional. They researched, they'd done a mountain of research. And I know whatever words I might say about them here today, it will fall far short of what should be said. And could I just say to those who I understand others are contemplating taking private members' bill, make sure you have the right team around you. Because I was, to some degree, envious of departments because they seem to have unlimited resources. A private member doesn't have that. They must gather their own team around them. Fortunately for me, I was able to do that, and I gathered some of the best expertise available in relation to this matter. Secondly, I want to say thank you to Women's Aid, Ruama and Space International for their support with regard to Clause 15. These organisations are doing invaluable work in supporting women in prostitution, not only here in Northern Ireland, but indeed in Southern Ireland also. And in seeking to see society change for the better, that's the work they're engaged in. I found the support of Sarah Benson, Geraldine Rowley, Rachel Moran, Louise Kennedy and Noel Collins to be of great value throughout this process. I am so thankful to them that they were willing to so positively engage with me to see Clause 15 become a reality. Their expertise and their commitment was total, and indeed it's appeared that when we spoke to them, nothing was too much trouble for them, and they applied themselves in producing and providing a lot of assistance to make this bill and get it to the stage that it is today. Thirdly, I want to also record my gratitude to the Law Centre and the Office of the Children's Commissioner. I am, of course, aware that the Children's Commissioner is not an NGO, but a quango of a sort, but it seems fitting to consider them here too. Both the Law Centre and the Office of the Children's Commissioner provided valuable expertise with regard to the introduction of a guardian for separated children. I hope that they can take pride of knowing that they played a critical role in seeing this provision become law. And furthermore, I would like to mention the name Gunilla Ekberg. Gunilla Ekberg is a world authority on this issue. She was a former advisor to the Swedish government when they were taking similar legislation through. And I was able to bring Gunilla on board with me. And again, I knew that I was in the company of someone who had a deep, deep knowledge and understanding of this issue. And I will be eternally grateful to her for all the expertise that she brought and brought so willingly and gave of her time unstintedly. Mr. Deputy Speaker, to conclude my remarks today, I want to make one thing very clear. Legislation is in and of itself will not make a difference if it is not effectively supported and enforced. Today may mark the end of the passage of the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Bill, but the most important part will begin once it comes into force. It is my hope that its provisions will make a real difference to helping some of the most vulnerable people in Northern Ireland, whether they are victims of trafficking for sexual exploitation, for forced labour or other forms of trafficking. I will be watching closely as the PSNI seeks to enforce the new offences and the Departments of Health and Justice seek to roll out the provisions in the bill, assuming, of course, that this House votes for the bill at this stage. I know that the Department of Justice and the PSNI will continue in their work to try to tackle these crimes. I do hope that my bill will assist their efforts in this area. Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
Mr. Raymond McCartney.
I just, in relation to this particular the final stage of this bill. I suppose I want to begin by commending the proposer of the bill for his work. I think he talked about it being a 3-year journey with half remission. That would be a 6-year sentence. So in that respect, I think he knows himself it has been a long journey. I think from a party point of view, and indeed on behalf of the Sinn Féin members on the committee, I want to commend him for the work which he carried out, and at all times the briefings which he provided as he was taking this bill through the process, and in particular clause what was formerly clause 6 and what became clause 15. And I think he has rightly outlined the many people who supported him in terms of what he called his team, and certainly some of those people themselves came and met with us as a party and obviously gave evidence to the committee. So we appreciate that work as well. I think we have to put on record, and Lord Morrow has already said this, in terms of the committee staff, the professionalism which they brought it, and indeed the department, because I think at all times, and I think it was where it was obviously a longer and more intense journey for the proposer of the bill, Lord Morrow, certainly for us as a committee, it was a very detailed piece of work, and obviously many of the briefings were very informative. I think, when Lord Morrow was speaking, he alluded to this. I think if you brought out the initial copy of the bill and looked at what is now going to be voted on this afternoon, you can see the difference it's made, and I suppose that's in itself a positive, in that, you know, what one person's intention is, then when they engage with all our people and certainly with the department, then it helped both shape and make the bill a better bill as it went through. Certainly, you know, from our point of view, there was a number of very important aspects of it. Certainly our visit to the Oireachtas Committee and their very detailed report also helped us inform it. And I think Lord Morrow mentioned Jim Wales. I think the most favoured person in Jim Wales' life at that particular time was Padraig McLaughlin. So I think Padraig McLaughlin goes away from this very heartened. I suppose there's one degree of disappointment in all this was at the further consideration stage. I said I hope perhaps that he would be invited to the DUP conference. That's now come and gone. He didn't get that invite, but I'm sure he lives in hope that he'll be invited back maybe next year. And I think that, again, and when Lord Morrow was concluding, he talked about this, because I think at the core of this bill is an attempt to deal with exploitation. And I think that's what we all were focused on. And I think he alluded to that, you know, there was issues of this with people needed, perhaps convinced, brought along a particular journey. And certainly the way it was carried out, I think, helped people do that. It wasn't seen as people being opposed or against something for the sake of it. There was genuinely held concerns. And I think the proposer of the bill does well in acknowledging that and accepting that and realising that, and then working very, very hard to change people's minds as a result of it. I think he talked himself, now that the bill, and we all can sort of know that later on this afternoon it will be voted through, that it is now about testing the effect of it. Because if we do set out to tackle exploitation in whatever form, then we have to ensure, because certainly we were guided by many of the questions which we asked, was the intention of the bill, its outcome, and then its effect. And I think now we would, as we go forward, for the effect. I think in terms of Lord Morrow sort of mentioned the work of the committee, and I want to add both to the committee staff and indeed to the chair, and he has alluded that the chair is now leaving, and certainly from the Sinn Féin point of view, I think throughout this bill and many aspects of it, there may be issues which we're divided on, but certainly there was never no barriers put up in members teasing out the questions, and sometimes that took very long sessions, and I think, you know, the chair is to be commended for that. Sometimes perhaps there's a tendency people want meetings over quickly, but I think in the Justice Committee we can say that is not one of the things that happened, because it allows people to ensure that they exhaust whatever particular avenue they want to exhaust in relation to interrogating or testing any piece of evidence, and it was similar for this bill. So we certainly will be supporting this bill, and again, in conclusion, just to commend the proposer of the bill for his work and indeed his courtesy throughout in all his engagements with both the committee and the party on separate matters. So, Gurumi Lamayoga, the last concluder.
Call Mr. Paul Given, Chairperson of the Justice Committee.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. On behalf of the Committee for Justice, I very much welcome the final stage of the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Bill. And I want to again place on record my congratulations to Lord Morrow and his team as we now enter the final straight for this bill. No one should underestimate the perseverance, hard work and commitment that it has taken to get the bill to this stage. Lord Morrow at length has thanked a broad range of people in terms of their support to him and for those that carried out the scrutiny of the bill. But it is Lord Morrow who had the vision and identified the need to try and do something. It's Lord Morrow who set himself the task of bringing forward a private member's bill, something which is very rare and very difficult to ever navigate through the Assembly. And often people will ask themselves, what did you ever achieve in politics? What was your legacy? And there is no doubt Lord Morrow will be able to look back on this bill as one of the most significant achievements of his political career and a legacy that will stand the test of time. And it's a legacy that was about helping the most vulnerable in our society. It's a legacy that was about giving a voice to the voiceless in our society. And I think that is a commendation that Lord Morrow is worthy of in terms of the way in which he has addressed this particular issue and the tenacity that he has shown in the face of, at times, obstacles that were put in his way and there was resources given by the department to try and undermine the work that was being done. So on the one hand, yes, I accept there was an engagement with the minister on these issues, but there was also an attempt, particularly around Clause 6, now Clause 15, to undermine this particular aspect of it. Despite all of that, Lord Morrow was able to navigate this through the Assembly because the strength of the argument was overwhelming and convincing upon members of this House. As I've said on numerous occasions, human trafficking is a heinous crime that devastates people's lives, as the Justice Committee has heard at first hand, and needs to be tackled robustly and from every possible angle, which this bill does. While the bill has undergone extensive scrutiny and consideration, both during committee stage and during the lengthy debates, particularly at consideration stage, and a large range of amendments have been made to it, the principles that Lord Morrow brought to this Assembly and the core of the bill have not changed. In bringing this bill forward, Lord Morrow wanted not only to provide a more effective legal framework to tackle and provide a deterrent to human trafficking and slavery offences, but also to provide the necessary support and assistance to victims of human trafficking, and the bill is very much an overall package rather than just the one clause, Clause 6, which is now Clause 15, that attracted so much publicity. When Lord Morrow first briefed the Justice Committee, he outlined that he wanted Northern Ireland to lead the way in protecting some of the most vulnerable men, women and children, and other countries to look at us as a model for tackling the scourge of human trafficking. He also wanted us to adopt a maximalist approach that was in line with the spirit of the EU directive and not just the letter of it. I have no doubt that the bill before us today achieves both objectives admirably. In my view, the Assembly should be proud of this bill. Indeed, during the recent second reading debate in the House of Lords on the Modern Slavery Bill, a number of speakers praised the bill. Lord McCall of Dulwich paid tribute to Lord Morrow and described the legislation as excellent and groundbreaking. Baroness Kennedy of the Shaws stated, "I too would like to see a greater synergy with Northern Ireland and what is being drafted in Scotland. I think it right that we have been ousted by Northern Ireland's progressiveness on this." Given the importance of the bill and the interest expressed in it, the committee spent a considerable amount of time undertaking detailed and careful scrutiny of all the clauses with the aim of ensuring that Northern Ireland should have the strongest possible legislation to tackle human trafficking. It was not an easy task, and some of the oral evidence relating to personal experiences was very difficult to hear. Those personal testimonies were very powerful, and I know they will stay in the memories for those members who have heard those testimonies from people when they came before the committee. The bill will consolidate and simplify the legislative framework around human trafficking and slavery offences, and introduces new offences and penalties which will strengthen the ability of the police and the courts to deal with the perpetrators. The committee welcomes this approach and the fact that the new offences will be triable on indictment only, and that a prosecution is not dependent on reporting or accusation by a victim and can take place even if the victim has withdrawn their statement. The committee also welcomes the fact that the Assembly supported the inclusion in the Bill of Clause 7, which provides for a minimum sentence in relation to human trafficking and slavery offences. The committee is clear in its support for a robust sentencing framework reflecting the gravity of human trafficking and slavery offences, and indicates the seriousness with which such offences are viewed in Northern Ireland, and believes this provision will send a strong message to the perpetrators of human trafficking. The bill also recognises the importance of providing appropriate training and resources for investigations and prosecuting human trafficking and slavery offences, and it places a requirement for the strategy provided for in Clause 12 to cover these issues, which allows for a comprehensive multi-agency approach. This is a necessary element of the overall package of measures to tackle human trafficking and slavery. Issues relating to whether a Northern Ireland rapporteur or a UK-wide anti-slavery commissioner was more appropriate to provide effective monitoring and accountability arrangements were raised and discussed during the committee stage of the bill. The debates at considerations and further consideration stages and the legislative consent motion debate at the Assembly yesterday also provided further opportunity to discuss the key issues, which I won't rehearse again today. Suffice to say, the committee supported the principle of having an independent body to monitor and report on response to human trafficking in Northern Ireland, but is now satisfied that the role and remit of the independent UK-wide anti-slavery commissioner will provide for this, and is therefore content that the remit of the anti-slavery commissioner should extend to Northern Ireland, and there is no longer any need for the bill to provide for a separate rapporteur in Northern Ireland. Turning to what is now Clause 15 of the bill, as previously indicated, this clause attracted the most attention, the most comment and the most controversy, and much of the written evidence received by the committee focused on this clause. Having listened to oral evidence from a wide range of organisations and individuals, including some who are currently or were involved in prostitution, and we held informal meetings with a victim of trafficking for exploitation and a sex purchaser. We visited Sweden. We met with the Oireachtas Joint Committee on Justice, Defence and Equality to discuss the findings of its report on a review of legislation on prostitution, which recommended the adoption of the Swedish approach of criminalising the purchase of sexual services. The committee agreed to support the inclusion of that particular clause in the bill, believing that the criminalising the purchasing of sexual services will curtail demand, lessen the incentive for human trafficking for exploitation, and thus reducing it and making Northern Ireland a hostile place for such activity. This stance was subsequently supported by the Assembly by an overwhelming majority, and in my view the bill is much stronger with the inclusion of this clause. The committee also accepted the importance of ensuring that support services are put in place for those who are in, have exited or wish to exit prostitution, and therefore is pleased that the bill now includes such a requirement. One of the key strengths of the bill in front of us today is the assistance, support and protection that it will provide to victims and possible victims of human trafficking and slavery. This includes a statutory defence for victims of slavery and human trafficking who have been compelled to commit offences, support and assistance, whether criminal proceedings are taken or not, the establishment of an independent guardian to assist, represent and support children, and the extension of the provision of special measures to victims of trafficking during the investigation and court processes. All these measures improve how victims are supported and treated and are very welcome. Finally, moving on to the commencement provision in the bill, the committee was the catalyst for the changes made at further consideration stage, and I am very pleased that as a result the vast majority of the provisions in the bill will come into effect either on Royal Assent or within 6 months of it, and the requirement for the Minister of Justice to commence provisions with which he is not in policy agreement has been removed. I would like to finish speaking as Chairman by thanking members of the committee for their commitment and diligence in carrying out the scrutiny of this bill. I have been privileged to be Chair of the Justice Committee, and I have been privileged to oversee the scrutiny work of this particular bill. the inquiry that the committee carried out into experiences of victims and witnesses of crime was a very important report, which will subsequently be legislated for in a forthcoming bill. But this bill is up there with one of the highlights of what the Justice Committee has had to deal with, and the way in which people did come to this, some with maybe different views, some with maybe hostile views to it. But as we listened to evidence, as we sought to do our scrutiny work and get into the detailed work of it, then I believe people opened their minds and were prepared to listen to that evidence. And as a result of that work, and I believe the committee played a critical role in facilitating that, we were able to get to the point where there has been overwhelming support for this. And the Justice Committee is very blessed in terms of its membership, in that undoubtedly some and most of its members are some of the brightest in this Assembly, and they bring a particular skill set to the committee where I note Edwin Poots has only just joined the committee, so I think it would be unfair to apply that maybe to him. But there are times whenever members will raise issues that I don't necessarily agree with. Indeed, I may not always agree with the manner in which it's raised, but I think it's important that members have the right to do that. And I, at times, have found that even though I may not have always appreciated some of the tactics deployed, it did actually unearth issues that some of us hadn't thought about, and it did reveal elements of the bill that maybe we did need to consider and tighten up, which maybe beforehand I may have taken a very supportive role, but as a result of some of the questioning, we were able to tease those issues out. So I think the committee is one of the best committees in this Assembly. It does nail down on what the real issues are and puts its mind to focusing on those very specific issues and trying to find a way to effectively deal with them. And I think other committees can learn from how the Justice Committee carries out its work. Some may say I am biased on this particular issue, but nevertheless, I think the committee is a model of good practice, and it is a good committee because we do get support from Department of Justice officials. They did support the committee as we scrutinised this bill, and I want to place on record as chairman my thanks for the work of the minister and of his officials in dealing with this. But I want to pay particular tribute to the work of the committee staff and to Christine Darragh, clerk of the committee. We unquestionably have been given the most professional support that I believe was necessary, above and beyond what indeed people may well expect in terms of the capacity that exists within this place to provide that advice to members. But there was not an issue that committee members raised from any perspective that Christine and her team in the committee office were not able to provide information to members to allow us to deliberate on these issues, and done so at all times entirely impartially. I could not tell you what any view is of the committee staff in respect of this bill. I don't know. I've never sought to find out, and none of the staff have ever sought to tell me whether they supported this bill or whether they were against this bill. And that is the entirely right way for officials to conduct themselves and provide that information so that members can deliberate and come to the right position on this once they have sought that information. So I want to thank especially the committee staff for all of their work in respect of this. Finally, let me put on record my appreciation to all of those organisations who came to the committee and engaged with it. We produced a report some 1,300 pages in length. We engaged extensively with individuals and organisations, and there is a broad body of work now that I have no doubt many other jurisdictions will now use the work of the Justice Committee as a reference point as they consider these issues. And let me, at the very end, just again reiterate my thanks and appreciation as an individual MLA on behalf of the Democratic Unionist Party to Lord Morrow, who we are immensely proud of for the way in which he has conducted himself over the past 2.5-3 years on an issue that I know has consumed every being of his life, every aspect of his day, he has been involved in dealing with this, and we are, as a party, immensely proud for the way in which he has conducted himself and been able to bring this legislation forward for approval now, and I would commend this bill to the House.
Order. Even though the Business Committee is not meeting today, it has agreed that there should be a lunchtime suspension. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. The first item of business when we return will be question time. The sitting is by leave.
Thank you very much. Order, members, and we now return to the final stage of the Human Trafficking Bill, and I call Mr. Tom Elliott.
Principal Deputy Speaker, thank you very much for calling me. And firstly, can I record my apologies to Lord Morrow and the earlier contributors to this final stage of the private members' bill, that I wasn't in the chamber. Obviously, business had moved on. I was caught unawares in that respect. I also add my apologies that I'll have to leave it after the next couple of contributions as well for another meeting. So apologies for that. But in regards to the bill itself, can I at this stage congratulate Lord Morrow for bringing the private members' bill to this stage? And it obviously wasn't without controversy, it wasn't without difficulties, and indeed at some stages quite heated exchanges, not only in the chamber here but also in the Justice Committee as well. But obviously we have got to this stage, and what we do want, and I'm sure this is what Lord Morrow is hoping for, is that it in fact makes it much more difficult to operate human trafficking throughout Northern Ireland. And hopefully that will be reflected in other jurisdictions as well, whether that's in the rest of the UK, whether it's in the Republic of Ireland, or indeed in wider Europe. And I think that is one of the main benefits that will be seen from this private member's bill. There was obviously one stage that there's one clause that was in the legislation at an early stage that I had particular issues with, that was, I suppose, given a reflection of people who may have committed human trafficking crimes in the past, that it may have given them leniency when it came to, I suppose, sentencing or indeed convictions, where they were effectively immune from conviction. But I'm pleased that Lord Morrow, in conjunction with the department, did remove that clause, and I think the bill will be much better for that. The clause around, obviously, what was clause 6 and is now, I think, clause 15, I can't remember exactly, but I'm sure it's clause 15, am I right? The Minister is agreeing with that. Caused a lot of controversy around the purchase of sexual services, and it was difficult at some stages to establish how many of the parties, how many of the individuals were going to support that, but in the end it got pretty widespread support. I think the jury will be out on that for some time to establish if it is indeed a successful part of the bill, and it will be interesting when the report comes back in 3 years' time just to find out the success of not only that particular clause but indeed of other aspects of the bill as well. And I look forward to that report coming forward. I think by and large that clause created a huge amount of difficulties. It caused a huge amount of division, if I dare say it, because there was no halfway house on it. Organisations and individuals were either for it or opposed to it, and that left it that there was no in-between mechanism for it. So I think in the end the decision has been right there, and I look forward to hearing what comes back through the report. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I think generally that is all I want to say on the final stage of this bill. I again thank Lord Morrow. I hope that the bill is successful, but obviously the outworkings will tell the tale in that, and we can be in a better position to make a judgment on how successful it will be in 3 years' time. Thank you.
I call Mr. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the bill at this, its final stage. We've had a robust and detailed debate in the committee and elsewhere with regards to this bill, and I hope Lord Morrow will agree with me that I have given the bill honest and fair scrutiny through that long process, a process which both he and the chair of the committee and others have referred to today. But there is one particular clause throughout the legislative process that every party has clearly expressed its abhorrence at the subject of human trafficking and modern-day slavery. And we have, and I have said in this place in a previous debate, that it is an evil and heinous crime. I believe, Principal Deputy Speaker, that every person has an inherent dignity, a value and a worth, and therefore regard human trafficking and slavery as a grotesque violation of human rights. In sharing this view, Lord Morrow has brought forward this bill to provide Northern Ireland with a robust legal framework in relation to these matters, particularly the prosecution of traffickers and those subjecting people to conditions of slavery, the provision of improved support services for victims, and the tackling the demand for services of trafficked victims. His bill also seeks to achieve improved compliance with our international obligations arising from the European conventions and directions. And the legislation has, and dare I use this term, evolved considerably since its introduction. For the most part, this has brought significant improvement, as Lord Morrow has, and he has readily acknowledged, worked closely with the Minister of Justice and this Assembly. It's a source of deep regret for me and for my party, however, that the Assembly has proceeded with the inclusion of Clause 15 on the criminalisation of payment for sexual services. But this is not because our objectives are immoral, as some would try to portray, but rather we have concerns about the possible dangers arising out of this clause for those who have been trafficked and also for those who work in the sex industry and have not been trafficked. We have strong justification for our apprehension, Principal Deputy Speaker. There's no evidence to suggest that the criminalisation of the payment for sexual services in other jurisdictions has resulted in a demonstrable reduction in human trafficking. But there is evidence that it has put women in greater danger, with the purchasers more reluctant to report incidents of suspected trafficking and to give sex workers information that can be assessed and vetted for risk. I consider the real possibility that we are putting trafficked victims and sex workers in greater danger is a deeply moral issue. This is certainly not as black and white as some would have us believe, but it is as clearly that they will be of the majority in this Assembly to proceed with the measure at this time. We must commit to revisiting it, and that has been done, and amending the law in the future if that is necessary and if the clause leads to negative outcomes. I am also concerned about the use of the tenuous and untested term sexual services as part of Clause 15. As I've outlined at previous stages, I believe this could lead us into uncertain legal territory with regards to other activities with a sexual component. I fear that this too will need to be revisited. We believe that Clause 15 does not reach the standard to which this Assembly should strive in terms of quality of legislation that we implement. It is, as I have said, however, clearly the will of the majority in this House that it is included in the bill. Notwithstanding the considerable apprehension which we have about Clause 15, we do recognise the significant benefits provided by the majority of the bill. It does simplify the legislative framework, it enhances provision to facilitate the confiscation of criminal assets, and it enables the payment of reparations and enhances services for victims. For all of those, Lord Morrow is to be commended. These measures represent a step forward in our fight against traffickers and those who would hold others in slavery and servitude. We also recognise that this bill alone is not a panacea. Its passage must be accompanied by renewed support for our police, anti-trafficking organisation and others who provide essential services to those affected. Today is certainly not the end of the road. The passage of this bill, we will move to a new stage. It is important that we recommit to tackling these heinous crimes and keep them on the agenda in the public square. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Jim Wells.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, in 100 years' time, very few people will recall who Minister Kennedy was, or Minister Wells, or even, dare I say, Minister Durkin. And they'll scratch their heads and they will wonder, who were these individuals? Did they make any contribution to Northern Ireland society? Were they any good at what they did? Were they worth putting into those positions of influence? But one thing I would say is in 100 years' time, everyone will still know the name of Lord Morrow of Clocker Valley. Because I see this decision today to back this absolutely crucial piece of legislation as one of the most important pieces of law that this Assembly will pass in this mandate. Lord Morrow started out on this, I suppose, pilgrimage, or journey, very long journey 3 years ago. And I'm sure he could never have envisaged when he started out just how complex, difficult, fraught, and time-consuming his private member's bill was. But he has stickability. He kept at it. There were many hurdles put in his place. The one thing I have to say about our party chairman and member of the Lords is he has tenacity and he keeps at things. And he really needed to show those talents, because there were times when many thought that this bill would never get any further than first reading. There were times in the committee when many, many hurdles were put up against it, and still he persisted. There was a vociferous campaign against his bill, led by those who have a direct pecuniary interest in the pursuit of prostitution. We saw many come before the committee, and I sat on the committee almost throughout the entire passage of this bill. And we saw many who came along pretending that they were in favour of rights for sex workers or in favour of civil liberties. But when one dug a bit deeper, inevitably one discovered that all of them had a pecuniary interest, a very substantial pecuniary interest, in this trade of trafficking women throughout the world for prostitution. A wicked trade, a fundamental breach of the human rights, mostly of women. And during that long passage, many of us were exposed to tales of horrific treatment of women who had been trafficked to Ireland, both north and south, from all parts of the world. Women who were promised that they were coming here for jobs in shops or as household staff or in the tourist trade or whatever, who had their passports removed from them, who were kept as slaves in various houses and flats throughout both Northern Ireland and the Republic, and who were expected to entertain or service large numbers of men. We all remember the story of the Romanian nurse who very bravely gave evidence to the committee. She was walking down the street, she was kidnapped, she was flown to Galway. She was locked in a room and expected to see 20 to 22 clients per day. She escaped 11 months later, her life completely destroyed by this evil practice. But still she had the courage to come forward to the committee and tell us of how evil this process is. Also, we saw within the prostitution industry in Ireland what was going on. One large concern who seems to have the market cornered, who advertise at any given night 300 women available for sexual services. And we had this dreadful situation that when the punters, as they're called, used these women, and there's no other word for it, or abused them, then they rated the women according to the sexual services they performed on a score of 10, and each woman carried with her a score as to her suitability for various acts. That is no way to treat the women of Ireland, North or South. And then we heard that those women were trafficked on a weekly basis from one venue to the next because the men who used them were demanding fresh entertainment. Again, a flagrant abuse of the rights of half of our population that should be even considered. And uniquely, Lord Morrow gathered together in unison a wide range of bodies in favour of his bill. Who else could bring together the Human Rights Commission, the Church of Ireland, Women's Aid, all, and the Evangelical Lads all coming behind in unison saying that this bill simply had to be pursued and simply had to be a success. And then we had the PSNI, who initially, I have to say, had a relatively hostile approach to the bill, particularly Clause 6 as it was then, now Clause 15, who, when they listened to the rational argument of those who had been trafficked, of those who had experience of rescuing trafficked victims, and those directly involved in the prostitution industry had got out, they changed their stance on this bill, and they will enforce it. But the ultimate deterrent of this bill is that any man abusing a woman through prostitution in Northern Ireland, if caught, can be taken and named in court for his abuse. In a little society like Northern Ireland, with 1.8 million people, that is an extremely powerful deterrent. I was part of the Justice Committee delegation that went to Sweden, where the Swedish or the Nordic model on which this is largely based was the genius of where this arrived. That legislation has been operating in Sweden for several years. And in Sweden, if one is caught abusing a woman through prostitution, you're taken back to your home by the police and you're introduced to your wife or your girlfriend. And the introduction by the police explains where the husband or the boyfriend was caught. You're then left with your wife or girlfriend for what is known as a very full and frank discussion. The repeat rate in Sweden was a mere 6%, and that's in a large cosmopolitan society of Sweden of 12 million people. I suspect in Northern Ireland, when that full and frank discussion has occurred between the husband and the wife, I would say the repeat rates are going to be a lot less indeed. This bill has had many detractors from the Alliance Party, and who no doubt try to pretend they're concerned about various aspects of Clause 15. I believe without Clause 15, this bill was meaningless. And Lord Morrow was absolutely right to stick to his guns throughout and make it absolutely clear he was determined to see this through. And they no doubt have the concern. But I'll just say this one thing. If this bill saves one woman from being trafficked and abused in some cellar or flat in Northern Ireland, then the bill will have been worthwhile. If one person can be saved the degradation and the humiliation and the loss of her, the loss of her personality and the incredible emotional distress of being trafficked and used for prostitution, then it will have been worthwhile. And I stand here pleased that my department, in various aspects, has been able to do much to encourage this bill. Some of those who did criticise the bill were absolutely right initially. It is absolutely essential that if this bill is a success and that if women leave the prostitution industry, we as a society must have the services in place to make certain in terms of health provision, accommodation, retraining, emotional counselling, that we can give those women, and it is mostly women, the full level of support that they will need when they come out of this dreadful industry. And therefore I am glad that we have reached agreement that my department, in conjunction with the Department of Justice, will indeed be able to provide that high level of care that is absolutely necessary. Because it stands to sense, as some of the Alliance Party even spotted, that if we don't give these women some alternative, inevitably they're going to go into things like drug trafficking, petty theft, to sustain sometimes a drug addiction or to support their family. So I believe what we now have in place is something that we can stand over and say that will give an alternative to those women who are at their very lowest. Now, the bill has a three-year review as it was passed by amendment. I agree with that. I think that is something that is right to be considered. And I believe that Lord Morrow's bill will stand the test of time. And when we do look at various clauses in 3 years' time, we will think to ourselves, why did we not do this earlier? Why did we allow a situation to continue? As we speak today in Northern Ireland, there are women who are locked in rooms, who are being abused terribly. And as Lord Morrow says, we don't have deniability anymore. We know that this is going on, and we can't turn the other way. We have a responsibility to do what we can for these people. So my message today is, well done, Lord Morrow. You're to be congratulated for your tenacity, your perseverance, and for having the vision to see this problem identified and devise legislation to tackle it. I believe this is this assembly at its very best. This was an assembly where we had very long discussions, both in the committee and the floor of the House, where there was really considered views on the bill, and even say, and it hurts me to say it, that even some of the Alliance Party contributions were well considered. They were well considered and totally wrong, but at least they were well argued. And I'm very, very glad to say that despite their protestations and the ambivalence of the Minister, that when the crucial vote came at the first consideration stage, it had an overwhelmingly vote of support from right across this chamber. So I'd like to say that in private members' bills, be it John McAllister's bill on caravans, grieves me to say it, but a very good piece of legislation, Mr Alistair's bill on advisers, and now this bill on trafficking and human slavery, I think we have a strong message to tell the community that when this Assembly is left to have a free and educated and intelligent debate, we can make very good legislation. And all I can say to Lord Morrow, well done, and remember, in 100 years' time, you'll be remembered when all the rest of us are forgotten.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Jim Alistair.
Thank you. I certainly do want to commend Lord Morrow in bringing forward this legislation. It's a difficult area of law, but it is, I believe, a necessary piece of legislation. And I think one looks forward to it rolling out and the implications of it. And I would commend Lord Morrow for his tenacity and in refusing to be undaunted by the torturous route that one has to travel to get to the point he's got to. Certainly it was, for me, in the bill that I sponsored, an eye-opener in that regard. And there are many more clauses and issues in this bill, and therefore I'm sure it was even more daunting. And it does take a tenacity and determination to see the matter through, and I commend him very much for that. In fact, when I was thinking about his bill, and I should welcome him to that very select band of MLAs who have managed to navigate legislation through the House, Mr. McAllister, and I think, though in this mandate, maybe Lord Morrow and I are the only two so far, but in welcome to that very select band of MLAs, I would say this. When thinking about his bill, and indeed my bill, three thoughts of similarity occurred to me, three parallels. Anne's Law was very much designed to chip away at terrorism and terrorists. Lord Morrow's bill is very much designed to chip away at the terror of human trafficking, and that is very important. Secondly, both of those bills were very much victim-centred. It was about protecting the victim in both bills that lay at the heart of the legislative purpose. And thirdly, both bills had the remarkable assistance of some very courageous women. In the case of Anne's Law, Anne Travers, of course, and in the case of Lord Morrow's bill, the support of a number of courageous women who came forward to tell very difficult stories, but vital stories, which were of immense influence and impact. So I do want to just place on the record my acknowledgement of the work done by Lord Morrow in piloting this bill through, and to congratulate him on a job well done.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I hope to join this select band of MLAs who've got private members' bills through this House, having moved to first stage of the Children's Bill yesterday. That, of course, will be up to this House, and I look forward to the second stage debate when I hear what people really think of it. There's no doubt the Human Trafficking and Slavery Bill speaks to an issue that is, I suppose, severe and grave. And I think I've said consistently throughout the passages of this bill, the stages of this bill, that we should not try to outdo each other at our abhorrence. I think we started from the basis of we had assembly that opposed human trafficking, saw its evils, and sought to legislate against them. But was there anyone with any doubt here? Mr. Wells, he does better than I ever could illustrate why this is such a heinous crime. But the question was always whether or not this bill will assist us in tackling human trafficking, and in that regard there is much about this bill that is to be welcomed. The bringing within the definition of victims, including those who are directly trafficked, but also those involved in forced labour, who may not otherwise have been captured by the law and given the protection that those who were trafficked would be given. The services and provisions for victims, suspected victims as well, that are provided within the bill should assist in supporting victims through the difficult process of both coming out of slavery, as the case may be, and indeed helping to persecute their traffickers. Compensation and protection from prosecution for victims, and although I have been contacted by some who still feel that victims are still at risk of prosecution, and I suppose over time with the outworkings of this bill that is something that can be reviewed as to whether it does go far enough in terms of that protection. But of course the clause of great controversy was the prostitution clause, and I still stand by my position that it could be counterproductive by the stated aims of this bill, which is to help in the fight against and indeed the discouragement of human trafficking. It has been mentioned that the 3-year review is included, and I think that is to be welcomed because we should have an evidence-based review. We of course do have evidence from other jurisdictions, but every jurisdiction will have its own. It will have its own different impact, and this bill will be assessed on its own merits and how it operates in Northern Ireland. It does need to be a robust review, and it must be evidence-based, and it must be based on the stated aim of reducing, tackling and prosecuting human trafficking, because that was the stated aim of the bill. The rights or wrongs of prostitution, to me was secondary in this bill. Human trafficking is the issue that we had consensus around, that we wanted to tackle, and as I say, that should be the focus of any review, whether or not this bill is effective in doing that. And I'll make one point. Mr. Wells spoke passionately about the need to protect women who are trafficked. But I have concern, and I'm certainly happy to give way if Mr. Wells wishes me to. I have concern that we come back to this idea of the deserving and the undeserving. Because when a sex worker appeared in front of the Justice Committee and was interrogated by Mr. Wells and indeed by Mr. Given, I did not see people who were fighting for the rights of women. What I saw were people who were making a judgment about the lifestyle of the woman in front of them. I certainly will give one.
The reason why the questioning by both myself and Mr. Given was so strident was that we knew that what we were dealing with was not a genuine sex worker, but a spokeswoman for the sex industry, someone who was inextricably linked to a ring of using over 300 women in Ireland for prostitution. We never actually met someone who was a genuine sex worker as such. We only were introduced to front women who were basically working for the sex industry, for the big conglomerates, who were using both trafficked and non-trafficked prostitutes throughout Ireland. That's why we were so cynical. And he also mentioned earlier about he was concerned still with Clause 15. Sweden, Iceland, Norway, and now the Irish Republic have all looked at exactly the same situation as ourselves. All are liberal democracies, and indeed they're democracy where the Greens were an important political element, and have all come to the same conclusion as to the best way forward by introducing the equivalent of Clause 15. How does he know better than all of those Western liberal democracies?
I think there's a number of issues where we can make the same point, and I think of terms of how we legislate for equality and how other countries legislate on equal marriage, and the fact that this is going to be the only region of these islands which doesn't legislate for equal marriage. I could make the same argument as the members opposite would make the case to me in those circumstances. We have to legislate as we see fit in Northern Ireland, and this is my best analysis on this subject. And I believe the evidence is mixed on this issue at best. I will not say there is no evidence to support the criminalisation of the purchase of sex. There is evidence, but there is also counter evidence. And I was left unconvinced that the best way forward was the criminalisation of the purchasing of sex. To come back to the member's point about having the representative that was in front of the committee, I take the member very much at his word, and I don't have facts to counter what he said, so I won't seek to.
I didn't have the benefit of attending the committee as well, but I am getting a little nervous about the references to organised rings and people with pecuniary interests. And I wonder just if a member, either in posing a question and inviting a response, we are in danger of impugning the reputations of people who are associated with those witnesses. Now, I am not speaking from any point of information in relation to the evidence that was offered, but it seems to me, listening to it, that we must be staying perilously close to making inappropriate references to people who have innocent associations with the witnesses who appeared. So can I just ask members to be extremely careful?
Principal Deputy Speaker, an intervention from Mr Agnew. I, at the committee, was very open and clear with the witnesses and made these accusations straight to their face and named them. So therefore, on this occasion, I am not. But I think, as the issue has been raised by Mr Agnew, one of the references I made in the committee directly to the person concerned was that her computer domain name for her so-called group supporting the needs of prostitutes was paid for by the wife of one of the largest pimps in the United Kingdom. Therefore, it was quite clear that she was indeed very much controlled by the industry. And this is a point I made and named her in the committee. So therefore, how independent can someone be representing the needs of sex workers when her office is maintained by one of the largest prostitution rings in the United Kingdom?
Okay, Ken, and I appreciate you finish your comments, but we're dealing now with the bill as it stands, not the kind of the process that brought it to this point, and I think people should return to the purpose of today's debate.
Okay. Thank you for that guidance, Principal Deputy Speaker. I suppose the last thing I'll say, and I'll make a generalised comment, is that I certainly stand to protect the rights of women, and I think it's not for me to make a judgment of how some women choose to live their lives insofar as it's compliant with the law, and I felt that at the committee some of the questioning went beyond interrogating this bill and into interrogating the lifestyles of people who were acting within the law. I suppose, finally, on that point, the issue of pecuniary interest was made, and there are no doubt that in any such issue there will be vested interests. But the allusion was made it was only those with a pecuniary interest who championed the opposition to the prostitution clause. And I would think of a group such as Amnesty International who would take great exception at that. They are an organisation who fight for human rights across the world. They're a charity and had no pecuniary interest in the position they took, and whilst members may disagree with it, as they're entitled to do in a democratic society, I think it's worth putting on the record that they had no pecuniary interest and their position was based on their best analysis of the evidence on how to best to protect the rights of women and to tackle human trafficking. As I said, finally, Principal Deputy Speaker, it's clear that this bill is to be passed, and I say there is much to be welcomed in it. I think it's for us now to ensure that in any such review in the future is robust and takes an evidence-based approach to the operation of this bill and its effectiveness and its state of aim to tackle the issue of human trafficking and slavery.
Thank you. And I call Mr. John McAllister.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and others have been kind enough to reflect on those of us who've had private members' bill, and I too am hoping to rejoin this group with my Assembly and Executive Reform Bill at some point. Principal Deputy Speaker, I would at least give Mr. Wells some credit. You know, he is not only is he Minister of Health, but he has already made it into the history books by I think outing a police officer that he caught smoking at a protest some 30 years ago in Hillsborough Castle. So when you're going, you know, it gives you a certain sense of how old Mr. Wells must be when you read about him in the history books, and you think, yes, I knew Jim Wells. I can tell my children I knew Jim Wells. So he has made his place in history as secure from all his activities and antics in the 1980s. I would say on this bill, and I would want to say a sincere and genuine congratulations to Lord Morrow. I know from my own experience, albeit in the last Assembly mandate, the work that goes into this in getting a bill to this stage and dealing with it, that you don't have a legislative team and a government department behind you. You have generally yourself and maybe one other assistant, and you have other groups, and you're trying to bring people together. It is a mammoth task, and to bring a bill of this size and significance is a mammoth task, and congratulations to Lord Morrow on his tenacity and his the hard work and endurance in getting to this stage. He will no doubt be aware that I didn't agree with every element of the bill. I had two main concerns at the start. Was one that there was some of it effectively repeating some of the laws we already have, and concerns around clause 6 or now clause 15. But nevertheless, to stick with a bill and to get to that. And yesterday, with the legislative consent motion around modern slavery bill that's going through Parliament. And I think the main thing I look at in these bills and the objectives that Lord Morrow in setting out this bill initially is to, and there's, you know, commonality and agreement throughout this Assembly, the scourge of modern slavery, the scourge of sexual exploitation, of human trafficking, the misery that brings, the lives ruined. I think there is no debate over that we as a society, as a nation, need to do all we can and play our role, both regionally in Northern Ireland, nationally in a UK context, and internationally, to limit this absolute apparent behaviour and crime that happens to all too many people. The very fact that today we have more people in slavery than at any point in our history is something that should shame our entire world. I would point out, and I know I'm fairly certain that the Minister was asked about the National Crime Agency during question time. Fortunately, I didn't hear that answer, but I would say it. I'm sure it was a particularly brilliant answer, Minister. But, Principal Deputy Speaker, I would say to colleagues, particularly to the right of me, not always to the right of me on many issues, but on this issue, that the work that Lord Morrow and it has been with this Assembly as stands tall in scrutinising that legislation and trying to shape it through committees and through debates in here, the work that the Minister has done in helping to shape that and helping make it as workable for the Department of Justice and for the Police Service, and the work indeed with that the Minister would have been involved in the Modern Slavery Bill. And I would remind colleagues in the SDLP, in the Modern Slavery Bill going through the House of Commons, one of the MPs that has made the biggest contribution to that has been Mark Durgan, the Member of Parliament for Foyle. And then we come to the bit that the National Crime Agency. I see, Principal Deputy Speaker, as vital that we have that to work on Lord Morrow's bill and to work on and implementing the Modern Slavery Bill to try and fight and eliminate the absolute scourge of human trafficking, the misery that goes with that. And we are going to be in a difficult time to implement and to get the best use of this legislation without, in a time of diminishing budgets for our police service, without tapping in to the expertise and availability of the National Crime Agency. So I would certainly, Principal Deputy Speaker, appeal to colleagues to rethink our commitment to getting the NCA in and working in Northern Ireland and to make the very best use and, of this legislation that the tools that we are giving our police service. Because this legislation, the mark of it being successful, and I agree with Mr. Agnew's point about the review, the mark of it being successful is that we end up with more prosecutions and more people before the courts and more deterrence out there. And that's something that I want to see, and I'm sure that Lord Morrow does as well. But, Principal Deputy Speaker, thanks and congratulations to Lord Morrow, to the Minister, to the committee for persevering and getting this piece of legislation that looks, I think there's a reasonable chance you're going to get it passed here today, Lord Morrow, but a sincere well done. Thank you.
And I call the Minister for Justice, Mr. David Ford.
Principal Deputy Speaker, I feel I should deal with the important business first of all. I actually had a private member's bill prepared in the first Assembly, but when the Assembly was suspended in 2002, it was lost. Speaking on behalf of the Executive on the substance of this bill, Principal Deputy Speaker, I welcome this final informed debate on what I do believe is a groundbreaking bill that puts Northern Ireland at the very forefront of the fight against human trafficking and slavery. In reinforcing our stance against those crimes, I believe it will act as a deterrent for would-be traffickers. Where people are exploited, it will help to ensure the perpetrators are properly punished, and crucially, it will enhance the protection and the support available for victims whose lives have been shattered by these abhorrent crimes. Members will, I'm sure, agree the landscape has changed quite significantly in the 3 years since Lord Morrow stood here and announced his intention to introduce this bill. The bill that was subsequently introduced in June 2013 sought to make Northern Ireland a more difficult place to traffickers to operate in and to improve the provision of support for victims. It also sought to achieve improved compliance with international obligations. I have been very clear from the beginning that these are worthy aims which I fully support. I'm satisfied that these aims have been preserved intact and indeed strengthened in the final bill before the Assembly today. So I want to start by paying tribute to Lord Morrow for bringing the bill forward and for leading it through what has been, I know, a very challenging journey. He's demonstrated dedication and tenacity in driving the legislation forward to reach this significant milestone. Now, in introducing the debate today, Lord Morrow said that... I'll give way.
Yeah, I wasn't sure. I thought of putting my name down, but the Minister got to the point of congratulating Lord Morrow. I think it's important that those of us who have followed this through the House do pay tribute to Lord Morrow for the time and effort that he has put into this bill. I suppose, and it's not always the case that we do pay credit to the Minister either for the work that he has done in working alongside Lord Morrow and doing that. So I think it's important, and I suppose it would be wrong of me not to refer to my colleague to my left who led the committee through that stage. So I'd just like to join with the Minister, and indeed, I think the Minister is referring to officials in the corner, so, but I just want to join, and I think it's fair to put on record the appreciation certainly from members on this side of the House have for our colleague Lord Morrow, but indeed to put on record the effort that the Department put in as well.
Grateful to the member for that intervention. I should clearly allow DUP members to intervene on my speeches more often. Lord Morrow, when introducing the debate, Lord Morrow referred to me being, I think the precise phrase was, sceptical in the early days. And I think that is a correct assumption. The Department was looking at the potential for secondary legislation, and I believe it would have covered the bulk of what is now in the bill. But it was clear as developments occurred, particularly in terms of linking up across the UK jurisdictions, that there was a wider need to look to primary legislation. And indeed, when I was attacked by Mr McAllister's former colleague at second reading, as to why I was supporting the bill when I had some reservations, I did a quick sum and said that if you support a third of the clauses, believe a third needs some amendment, and you're not too sure about another third, that is no reason to oppose a bill at second stage. The bill is now, of course, rather longer than when it appeared at second stage. It's rather more complex. It bears the mark of a lot of work. But it is, of course, also much more agreed than the proportions which I said were agreed at that stage. And whilst we certainly disagreed on some measures, Lord Morrow and I believe the House as a whole, are united on the Bill's fundamental principles. Indeed, I'm pleased that we've been able to work so collaboratively, as so many members, not just Mr McRae, have highlighted on the vast majority of the provisions in this Bill. So I want to again put on my record my thanks to Lord Morrow for the openness, the flexibility and the willingness that he's shown throughout this process to ensure that we make the bill the best possible bill for Northern Ireland. It's absolutely clear his desire to combat human trafficking and modern slavery. He's firmly established himself as a key figure in highlighting these appalling crimes, and he's played a part in the Westminster legislation as well. And I have no doubt that he will continue to engage with my department as it works to implement the measures which are in the bill, on the presumption we're about to pass it shortly. Can I also, when I praise Lord Morrow, praise in particular amongst those who worked with him, Mark Bailey from CARE and I, who's provided support to Lord Morrow throughout the bill and who's worked very closely with my officials to resolve concerns and to identify the effective policy solutions to make the bill so effective. Lord Morrow also referred in particular to one of my officials, Judy Wilson. Unfortunately, I don't think she heard it directly. I've no doubt he'll repeat his praise in a few minutes' time. But can I add my thanks to Judy Wilson and her team, who have put in an awful lot of effort into ensuring that this bill is the best possible bill. Lord Morrow said that he expected Julie to be, quote, pleased to see the back of me. I suspect she probably won't see the back of him, and I'm not sure she wants to be pleased by seeing the back of him, though I suspect we will all be pleased at the end of this laborious progress to see the back of the bill. The important issue is to see that the work goes forward with the Department of Health in other aspects, a range of justice agencies and a range of our NGO partners working together to ensure that the bill is implemented. And certainly the input from a number of those NGO partners through our engagement group within the department, as well as through those who've worked with Lord Morrow, has been key. And as others have said, I should also acknowledge the work of the Justice Committee, which has also played an integral role in shaping and informing the bill, has done the detailed scrutiny and deserves our thanks for that, in particular to Paul Given and Raymond McCartney, the Chair and Deputy Chair, but to all those members who played a part in it, for helping develop the legislation, and along with them, Christine Darra and her staff in the committee. There's been very valuable contribution from around the Assembly, and I'm confident that we now have robust, comprehensive and effective legislation, which, despite the changes, the massive number of amendments we've passed, is still very much Lord Morrow's intent. I should also acknowledge at this stage my thanks to the Office of Legislative Counsel, which has tirelessly provided the usual sage advice and guidance to ensure that the bill is effective and appropriately written to match the sponsor's intent. Principal Deputy Speaker, I've said before on many occasions that the nature of human trafficking is such that no one individual, department or agency working alone can tackle it. We need to build an effective partnership, and I do believe that this bill exemplifies the common goal and the partnership we've done. And whilst final stage is not the place for a clause-by-clause analysis, I would just like to take a few minutes as Minister to remind the House of what we hope to achieve through this bill. The bill consolidates and reinforces the legislative framework around human trafficking and slavery. It brings together new offences for the first time in a single piece of legislation, so the law is streamlined, simplified, to assist investigators, prosecutors and the courts. In doing so, importantly, it gives equal weight to human trafficking and slavery-like offences. Both types of offences will be triable only on indictment, with each attracting a maximum sentence of life imprisonment. The new sentencing framework provided by this bill will enhance public protection and send out a powerful message to would-be traffickers and enslavers that Northern Ireland will simply not tolerate these evil practices. We will see the introduction of new STPOs to help bolster public protection, as well as adding a further risk of personal risk to those who are involved at whatever level in exploiting others, and so will act as a deterrent. Law enforcement has described human trafficking and slavery as high profit and low risk. I believe the new powers to confiscate criminal assets, to force perpetrators to pay reparations, will not only help victims, but will also disrupt this profit-risk dynamic and so dilute the economic driver that fuels these crimes. In short, Principal Deputy Speaker, taken together, the package of provisions set out in the clauses of Part 1 of the Bill will improve our understanding of these types of crime and will help to protect the public, as well as boosting our capacity to respond effectively and robustly to perpetrators. Of course, there is one small part of the Bill, originally Clause 6 and latterly Clause 15 in Part 2, on which Lord Morrow and I did not agree, on criminalising the purchase of sex. This one clause took up more than the lion's share of debating time, and I do believe diverted the focus away from some of the other important measures which I've just outlined and into the moral issues surrounding the purchase of sex. Lord Morrow has stated that the motivation for this new offence was to reduce the market for women trafficked into sexual exploitation, but invariably other reasons have been put forward. My view has always been that policy cannot be developed properly and the Assembly should not make law without a sound evidence base. I remain disappointed, therefore, that the research on prostitution which I commissioned from Queen's University, which was published before consideration stage, was ignored and indeed at times derided. In part, it was because it portrayed the views of sex workers who had until then not been heard, and because it destroyed a lot of the stereotypical imagery of prostitution. I think I can do no better than briefly quote, as we look at part two of the bill, from one of the sex workers who was interviewed as part of the research. She said, "I used to respect government. I used to think they did things because they really put a lot of information into learning about things and making real decisions based on real facts. They're not making any decisions based on facts. They're making decisions for the rest of the country without really bearing in mind what the decisions are to be based on, and I feel so disillusioned, because they don't care about me, because they're not interested in what I have to say." But whilst we still have disagreements around Part 2, that should not detract from where we all agree about the positive aspects of the bill. Lord Morrow has made clear, and I entirely agree with him, that victims are at the heart of this bill and have to be at the heart of our work in the future. The folk... Oh well.
And I just ask for the intervention because of how he has outlined where he believes that Lord Morrow and others have ignored the facts whenever all of the evidence presented to the committee demonstrated there is a mountain of evidence that shows criminalisation of the purchasing of sexual services is the right way to go. Others can produce other evidence and we can get lost in a debate of here's evidence that says this, here's evidence that says that. Bottom line, MLAs had to make a decision and the majority accepted to do that. Does the minister, though, still not regret the fact that he decided at the 11th hour to throw tens of thousands of pounds into an effort to try and undermine this clause whenever he should have known that the game was already up, and instead Queen's engaged in a piece of work that I hope they reflect upon in terms of the shoddy quality that was actually produced by prejudiced researchers that were involved?
Well, Principal Deputy Speaker, the DOJ is not in the business of commissioning shoddy, prejudiced work. Work was commissioned to assess the nature and extent of prostitution in Northern Ireland. Some members may not like the result of that research, but it was commissioned to be genuine research, and it was on the basis of that evidence that the DOJ took its decisions. But let's look at the remaining aspects of the bill on which there is significant agreement. In particular, the focus of Part 3 on providing assistance and support that will help vulnerable individuals, victims and potential victims to take the necessary steps to rebuild their lives. It will also provide essential protections for children who have been trafficked or who are considered to be separated children. And on behalf of the Executive, I welcome the inclusion of these vital measures within the bill. They are, of course, the responsibility of DHS SPS. I've no doubt, had the Minister of Health, Social Services and Public Safety been taking part in this debate, he would have agreed with the points which I've just expressed on his behalf. The provisions in Part 4 of the bill will also enhance the protections available for victims of these offences in criminal investigations. These are important measures which I believe will help give victims renewed confidence to take a stand against their exploiters without facing additional trauma and, in many cases, protection from prosecution for certain crimes that they may have been compelled to commit. If I could digress and ignore your earlier suggestion, Principal Deputy Speaker, that we should stick to what is in the bill, I would like to briefly refer to Part 5 of the bill, the Northern Ireland Rapporteur, which is no longer there, and again emphasise that that was the result of good work done between Lord Morrow and his team and my team in persuading the Home Secretary that we had a better solution, which we saw when we passed the LCM yesterday. There are very significant aspects to this bill, and in the great majority of them, Lord Morrow and I are as one, along with, I believe, the great majority of this House. I'm grateful that we have been able to work together on shaping the bill. I believe we now have a robust bill, which is clearly the original bill that Lord Morrow introduced in intent, but significantly improved in its practical operation by the input from DOJ, OLC and a range of others who were consulted. It is an example of what can happen when we work constructively together in this place. A private member, a range of NGOs, the department, the committee, other officials working together. It's an example that we should perhaps celebrate, because we have few enough examples to celebrate of that constructive good work. But we now have an important piece of legislation that I believe will make Northern Ireland safer and freer from these kind of criminals, from those who would exploit others in such a horrific way, and I believe it will make a material difference to the lives of vulnerable people. I congratulate Lord Morrow on his achievement in bringing the bill thus far, commend the bill to the House, and trust that we will see it pass shortly.
Thank you, and I now call the Lord Morrow to conclude the final stage.
Principal Deputy Speaker, I barely know where to start. I'm slightly overwhelmed with many generous remarks that have been made here in the House today, even by those who would maybe be on the side of detractor. Nevertheless, it's good to see that even they too have something good to say about this piece of legislation. But I think I will leave the what others have said to the end of what I want to say, because there are some few words that I want to get on the record which I feel are important in relation to this bill, which I hope will pass in the not too distant future. Principal Deputy Speaker, I want to say first of all that I'm very glad to have the last word today in this debate, and I would like to thank members for all their kind words today. Some of the comments have been maybe far too kind, but that's how debates in politics sometimes turn out. I won't lie to members, this process has been far from easy. And it's a good job I didn't realise what was ahead of me before I started. I might have stepped back from it, but anyway. For other members contemplating bringing forward a private member's bill, let me tell you that the process is a lengthy one marked with many, many hurdles. You will have many highs and lows, and at points you may contemplate giving up. Having gone through the process of this bill, I can honestly say that I fully understand what Otto von Bismarck is believed to have said, and he said, "Laws are like sausages. It's better not to see them being made." And I experienced that. I suppose one point I would humbly make from my experience is that it may be a good idea to increase the level of support from the Assembly here provided to private members seeking to bring forward such legislation. Now, don't get me wrong, I have had some wonderful help throughout this process from NGOs, staff at this Assembly, and indeed from the Department of Justice itself. And I've already acknowledged that earlier, and I don't detract one word from what I have said. However, perhaps it would be fruitful at some point for this Assembly to look at how it can support private members seeking to bring forward legislation. Principal Deputy Speaker, I hope that members from right across this House will feel able to support this bill today. I strongly believe that it is a good bill, that it will make a real difference in terms of responding to and tackling the crime of human trafficking. I have been privileged to be able to bring this bill through the House, and I hope that it will send a strong message that our society will not tolerate human trafficking and that we will not let the victims of such crimes down. To conclude my opening remarks, I have one last remark in this stage. It is my hope that even in a small way, this bill will have helped to raise awareness of the horrendous reality of human trafficking in modern-day Northern Ireland. This legislation will not, and of itself, eradicate human trafficking. Ultimately, doing so may prove impossible. However, this does not mean that we should not try. And if we are to move towards this goal, we need our society as a whole to be clear that we will not tolerate human trafficking, that we will be tough on those who perpetrate such acts, and that we will support those who are victims of such acts effectively. It is my hope that this legislation will contribute to such a goal. If I could turn then briefly to what some members have said, and I have detected that some are very enthusiastic about this piece of legislation. I have detected that there are those who have mixed feelings about this legislation. And I've also detected that there are those who want to see this legislation tested before they will give it their final approval. That's not unreasonable. But I do say this to them, to everyone here today, that I believe that doing nothing was never an option. Raymond McCartney, when he was speaking, he acknowledged the volume of work that has gone into it. And if you believe nothing else that I ever say in this Assembly, believe me when I say there was a massive volume of work included and undertaken during this whole process. He also acknowledged that those who were working with me and the papers that we presented, we'd done it in a wholesome way to the best of our ability to ensure that those who were deliberating on this piece of legislation were informed as much as we could give. And I think that we can confidently put our head upon the pillow tonight and say that we did achieve that, that we gave as much information as we possibly could to help those who were making decisions to make informed decisions. Paul Given has been very enthusiastic about this bill. He has led the committee with enthusiasm and indeed in a very talented way. And I would be failing in my duty if I did not acknowledged that. He posed the question of those to us all, not alone to me, but to us all, and he asked the question, when your political career is over, and I'm not saying anyone's political career is over here, I want to make that very clear, what will be the achievements that they'll look back on with some satisfaction? Deputy Speaker, I entered politics into the elected arena of politics in 1973. Now, I know you're all muttering under your breath and you're saying, you know, he doesn't look that age, you know, but it was then. So for the past 42 years or thereabouts, I have been in politics at different levels. And I have to say that this piece of legislation has been the one I think that has tested me the most. And I hope that I have passed the test. And I hope that when all is said and done, that even those who have still reservations will one day come round and say, yes, this legislation is good for Northern Ireland. It does what it says on the tin, and it tackles the scourge of human trafficking. Tom Elliott also commented on Clause 15. He queried if, in fact, it would be effective. I am convinced that it will be effective. But for anything to be effective, it must be enforced. And we will now look to others who play that role in society. And we serve notice on them today that we will be watching very, very carefully to see and hear of the enforcement of this piece of legislation. Stuart Dixon, while he acknowledged it was a robust piece of legislation in an attempt to tackle human trafficking, he still has many reservations about it. Well, I sincerely hope as time goes by, he will come to acknowledge the merits and the effectiveness of this piece of legislation. He again is sceptical of Clause 15, which was Clause 6 in the previous bill. So I say to Mr. Dixon today that I think that you will come to acknowledge that this piece of legislation is necessary and is effective. But at least he did acknowledge that it had overwhelming support in this House, on which over 89% of those voting voted for this clause. That actually boils down to something like 92% of people voting in Northern Ireland have actually voted for this piece of legislation. I am doubtful if there will be any other legislation will receive that degree of support in the coming days, in particular a piece of legislation extending to this size. Well, Jim Wells spoke for himself. Jim Wells, I think everyone was in no doubt as to where Jim is in relation to this piece of legislation. And to Jim Wells today, I say to him, well done, I value your support, and you have been an enthusiastic supporter from day one. You hadn't to be brought on board, you could see the merits of it right away, and I want to thank you, and not only as an MLA, but also in your capacity as a minister. Jim Allister, when he was speaking, he acknowledged the merits of the bill. He drew a parallel with his own bill, which I thought was significant, in this, that he said, at the heart of his bill, at the heart of my bill, was the concern for victims. And that's right. This bill is all about delivering for victims, victims of human trafficking. That's what it's about, and to provide support for them. Stephen Agnew, I don't think I haven't convinced. I see he's not here at the moment, but he too was sceptical of Clause 15. And to him I say, well, you will have to wait and see for the outworkings of this piece of legislation. And as time goes by, I hope too that he will come to realise and acknowledge and support this piece of legislation, which today he is still sceptical of. But he also acknowledged that there are many good aspects in the bill, while he didn't support it in its entirety. Principal Deputy Speaker, it was just about this time last year, or a week further ahead, that I went to Sweden And I met with the head of the police in Stockholm, who's in charge of combating human trafficking. I listened to what he had to say. I also met the Swedish rapporteur. I listened to what she had to say. I listened and talked to prosecutors in Sweden. I heard what they said. And as a result of visiting Sweden, I am convinced that this legislation can work effectively here in Northern Ireland. Now, I think that while my bill is based on the Swedish model, it is not entirely as it is in Sweden. However, I believe it can be a very effective piece of, and if it is as effective here in Northern Ireland as the equivalent is in Sweden, then I think that this Assembly will have done everyone a favour, in particular victims of human trafficking. Mr. McAllister, he acknowledged that a bill of this size calls for some endurance, and I think I'm with him at one on that. You can be dead right, Mr. McAllister. There was time endurance was called for. He again is sceptical of Clause 15, formerly Clause 6 in the previous print of the bill, but he too is looking forward to the review of the bill in 3 years' time to see the outworking and to see how effective it is. And I hope in time, and in that period of time, he will be convinced that this bill is necessary and is working. Yes.
I pay tribute as well as a former member of the committee to the member for the work that he has done in the background in ensuring this bill progresses through the House. Those who would be sceptical of Clause 15, formerly Clause 6, had they listened to the witnesses that were brought before the committee and indeed listened to the testimonies that we heard while in Stockholm, both from those people involved in the sex industry and also the police, they will be very clear this bill is about protecting the most vulnerable people in society. That's our duty and responsibility, to protect the most vulnerable who cannot protect themselves, including the young lady from Bucharest who was kept in a room, a very small room, a filthy, dirty room, got no payment and had to service up to 19 or 20 clients per day. Would the member agree?
Well, yes, I do. And I think that those who listened and heard the evidence from, in some cases, victims of this, I still fail to understand how they cannot see the merits in this particular clause, Clause 15. Indeed, I thought if there was anything that would dispel the concerns and apprehensions and the misgivings of those who were in opposition to Clause 15, as it was then Clause 6, then I thought those would have been dispelled. And I must say I'm at a loss to understand how they could listen to that evidence and still take the position that this is not necessary. Minister Ford, and I want to say this, that Minister Ford and I have had a good working relationship. I do recall the very first meeting that we had on it, and to say it was frosty, that would be an understatement. However, there seemed to come a thaw as we progressed our way through this bill. And he did come to the discussion, the debate, the table, the work on this bill in a very businesslike way, and I would be failing in my duties if I didn't pay tribute to him here this afternoon. He did say that one thing that struck me, and I might hold him to this in the future, he thought it would be a good thing if the DUP members intervened more often in his speeches. I would just say this to the Minister, not every day will be like this, and he might regret encouraging that because you just might be taken up on it. Clause 15, again, he said that he was concerned about it. And he then referred to the Queen's report on prostitution. Now, I would be less than honest if I didn't say that I perceived that report and its time of release as a distraction. And let me say why. This bill, Principal Deputy Speaker, has been almost 3 years in the making. Could I be forgiven for thinking that on the eve of one of the most important debates on this bill, the Minister decides to release a report into prostitution? I will let the House decide on that one. And I'm sure they might conclude that it's more than coincidental that on the eve of an important decision being made, we get out of the blue this report, and I'll say no more in relation to that. I do want to return to one person. I did not know whether she was in the House when I said it or not, but the Minister has encouraged me to do it. But I did mention Julie Wilson here today. And if anyone is worthy of special mention in relation to all of this, Julie Wilson stands head and shoulders above the rest in this respect. I made many phone calls, I made many emails, many letters, many meetings, and all those correspondence did not happen, Principal Deputy Speaker, between the hours of 9 o'clock and 5. This civil servant, in my opinion, went beyond the call of duty. She went what I would call the second mile. And that is not in any way saying that she supported the bill, she didn't support it. She never told me one way or another, nor did I ask, because I would know not to. But I do want to place on record today the superb work, the professional approach, and the way she carried out her business at all times, and her attitude. And I think that, as I said earlier, the Minister should treasure her and make sure that she stays in that department, because she is a real asset to it. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I'm going to stop there. But I do commend this bill to the House, and I look forward to it passing here today, and also not only passing here today, but being enacted and being effective in tackling the scourge of human trafficking. I want to thank all those who participated, not only here but at other levels, and I very much appreciate it indeed. Thank you.
The question is the Human Trafficking and Exploitation (Criminal Justice and Support for Victims) Bill do now pass. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.